Good morning, coffee drinkers. It is Q&A. There are a lot of questions. Let's get right to it. First question is from Ron DiCarlo, who asks, what is the song you hated to play, but you did it anyway because the band liked it, the audience liked it, and you're getting paid to play it? Okay, those are sort of three conflicting components, I would say, because the band liking it is kind of, if you look at the, you're getting paid to play it, everyone's getting paid to play it in the band then. So the band liking it is kind of a little bit insignificant. That's an individual thing. If you're looking at it in terms of a band working with an artist and not being an actual band, I would say that there were tunes when I was playing as a sideman with pop artists and just artists in general that were not as inspiring to play as others. And also, once you say yes to a gig, that's it. You're doing it. So you'd better really respect that, I think. That's huge. And be super professional about it as well. So you should play the song in the set that you love with just as much energy and commitment as you play the song in the set that you hate if you're working for someone else and you're being paid to do that. Next question is from Mi Pa Bass, who asks, any news about the upcoming signature bass? Yes, I am meeting with the Mystery Luthier in New York in a few weeks' time. I'm going to play a prototype, one or two different prototypes and different ideas that we're talking about. I don't think anything will be ready for NAMM 2018, which was our original plan, but yes, we are getting a lot closer on that. And as soon as I have something that's a little more solid and a little more set, I will share that with you guys. Next question is from Liam Keeney, who asks, can Chelsea give you a lesson on upright bass? She sounded great the other day. She always sounds great. And yes, she can and does give me lessons on upright bass every time I go into her office and grab it, which we've only been here like 6 days, so that's not too many times yet. But every time I have, she's given me very welcomed pieces of advice and pointers as to how to create a better sound and how to play the instrument better. Next question is from Timothy Ritchie, who asks, I would still like to know how you plan out a set of songs as a solo artist or as a band leader. Maybe that question has been asked and I've missed it before, so sorry if that is the case. I think the situation is quite different for me if I have a band with me or if I'm playing solo. When I'm playing solo, I may have an idea for what I want to play first, and I might possibly have something that I'm saving in the back of my head to play last, but when I plan for that, it almost always changes in terms of the end of the set. So the completely solo shows where I'm just looping and playing by myself are really loose, and it changes throughout the night, and you know, it can go in any direction. With the band, I tend to have a little bit more of a plan, but if I'm working with people I've worked with a lot in the past, then it can be exactly the same as the solo shows, and we can just change direction in a heartbeat and go anywhere we want. Timothy also asks, also, do you own less skin-tight jogging bottoms? Do I own less skin-tight jogging bottoms than whom? Does somebody own more than me? Do I own less than somebody? I think I probably own less than somebody else. I'm pretty sure there are people with more just jogging bottoms in general than me. Yeah, pretty sure about that. Next question comes from Moo Moo Cow 8, who asks, are there other ways other than transcribing that help you get a better ear? Developing your ear is all about using it, I think. And, you know, maybe not necessarily writing down what you're hearing, but being aware of what you're hearing and developing your ear as you listen in real time to music. That's the only way I know of doing it in the very broad sense. Of course, there are conceptually many, many layers to that and many details that you can employ, transcribing being one of them. But using the tool that you are trying to improve, using the muscle, that, i.e. your ear, that you're trying to improve is definitely the way to go. So probably just the constant use of your ears is the best advice I can give you. Next question is from Ollie B, who asks, are there any musicians you wish made a vlog? If so, who would they be? And would you watch it every day? You know, Questlove from The Roots used to post a lot, and I used to watch those things, and it was very kind of like holding the laptop up with the FaceTime camera and kind of cruising around on the road and making videos, and that was kind of cool. Plus, he's an intelligent dude. He knows a lot about music and a lot about life, and I'm always interested in people like that. I think if Seth Godin made a vlog, that would be pretty amazing. He does have a daily blog, which I read, and there are a lot of people that create daily content that I do follow, but it's mainly in in the written form. You know, I watch Bob's vlog from time to time, although that's not a daily thing. You know, I was a big fan of the Casey Neistat vlog when it was every day. To be honest, since I started making this vlog, and we are at day 307 today, it's been a full-time job. And I don't wish that workload upon anyone else. And I don't think there are many people out there in the world who actually have the time and the patience to do it. So I think in theory, I would love to hear from, you know, hyper interesting and intelligent people from all walks of life in video format on a daily basis. But the reality of it is that I don't think it would ever happen. Ollie B also asked, kind of a cool question actually, if you could have dept, and I'm guessing Ollie B is English because dep is the English word for sub on a gig. If you could have dept on any of Chelsea's gigs, which would it have been and why, and vice versa? So, I think I like the fact that Chelsea does a lot of TV work, and TV work pays pretty good, and it can be a lot of fun as well. They're long days and they're hard work, but it can be a lot of fun. It's like two different worlds meeting, of music and actors, or music and the different kind of studio environment and the kind of the pressure of it. I like those kind of things. Like, Chelsea was the musical director on a late night TV show, so I definitely would have dug subbing on that gig or depping on that gig. And I literally just texted Chelsea to ask her what her response would be. And she said, I briefly, super, super briefly, played with Khalees. You might remember this singer had a song called Milkshake. My Milkshake Brings Little Boys to the Yard. So she said that gig she would have liked to have done because she dug that song. And Bob Reynolds' band. She's a big fan of the band and has been listening to that music for a really long time. So those were her choices of my gigs. Next question is from David Richards, who is a bass player and a drummer, and is asking about improving his technique, saying that technique takes time to develop. I'm a working musician who plays both bass and drums, but would like to take the time to refine my technique. Would you suggest I stop working for a while in order to unlearn the old and assimilate and develop the new? I don't want to sabotage progress. At least that's how I'm thinking about it. Thanks for your help. Well, I think it's really all about refocusing and basically your intent. I don't think you need to stop working. In fact, I think it's really healthy to carry on working, but adjust the way you think and where your intent is. And I think it's about getting to the comfort zone, to getting to the place where you feel most comfortable playing music, whether that be on the bass or the drums for you. And it really doesn't matter what instrument you play. I think this advice goes across the board for all musicians. And by the comfort zone and by your intent, I mean that you want to be the most relaxed. You want to be the most centered when you play, and you want to feel like you can do anything. You want to feel invincible. I think that's always the goal. That's always what I'm looking for. I'm looking for that fluidity, for that total state of flow. Now, that's not going to happen immediately. Sometimes, even though I can get into that more often than I could 20 years ago, it doesn't happen all the time for me. I don't think it happens all the time for anyone out there. So in your practice, that's what you want to be working on the most. And then when you're performing, when you're out working and actually gigging and being a musician in the real world, hopefully you're not under a lot of pressure. So you can really start to concentrate on your state of mind and on your state of relaxation. And then try not to bring out like everything that you're working on while you're practicing. Don't bring everything, including the kitchen sink, with you to the gig. Maybe you go to the gig with just one thing you want to improve upon while you perform that night. And who knows, when you're drumming, maybe that's the relaxation of your right hand, if you're right-handed, as you hit the hi-hat. And that's good. Everything else, obviously, you're a musician, you are working now, you've been playing gigs, you have some experience. I don't know to what level that is, but I'm guessing that you can play and you're out there doing gigs. So that's more than enough to where things are going to fall into place pretty naturally to a certain comfort level, to a certain level of ability. And then the improvements that you're looking to make and the technique that you're looking to refine, if you take one thing from where you're practicing during the day out onto the gig, and maybe it's that hi-hat thing, maybe it's the way you transition from the flat part of the cymbal to the bell when you're playing a groove out on the ride cymbal, no matter what it is, maybe you really just want to refine the process on the gig to one thing, maybe two things. And as your confidence grows, as you feel your technique improving from the work you're putting in during the day, you can increase the number of things that you're working on during the gig. And of course, those things are all, before long, gonna become completely second nature, and you won't have to be conscious of that thing, ride cymbal, bell to the flat part. You won't have to think about any of that. It's just the intent. You're gonna go on that gig knowing you have this base level of ability that isn't going anywhere, You know, we have those, that doubt creeps in and stuff, but no matter how much doubt we have, and trust me, I have a lot of self-doubt a lot of the time, but I've also trained myself to know that my base level of ability is good enough to get through almost any gig. So even if I feel like crap about the way I'm playing, the gig is still gonna go off without a hitch. So get to know what your base level is. Know that you can rely on this certain amount of experience you have, and then add little things on top of that. That would be my advice. Okay guys, this is the last question. There were like, I think over 60 questions on this. I can't thank you enough for the outpouring of comments and questions whenever I say I'm gonna do a Q&A. It's huge, and I wish, this would be 3 hours long if I tried to answer every single question. So if your question didn't get answered, you know, save it up. I'll do another Q&A in the not too distant future, and I will again try and get to as many as possible. Our last question for today's Q&A comes from Alex Connor, who asks, "Hey Janek, love the vlogs." Thank you, man. "Been keeping up since day one." Wow, real coffee drinker there. "Whenever I hear you begin to solo, there's a real prominent African slash Brazilian slash Latin influence, not only in phrasing, but in note choice. I was wondering where this comes from, a specific scale, an intervallic relationship possibly, and where I might look to incorporate this into my playing." Alex, I don't know. That's interesting. The note choice, I'm not sure whether it's a scale or interval, I don't think so. I know what you mean about the rhythmic element. And South American music in general has been a huge part of my playing from day one because, you know, one of the first things I ever did of note, of real impact in my music and on my life was to play with Ayeto Moreira and Flora Purim over 20 years ago now. That was really like the first big thing I ever did before I even moved to the States. And it was Flora Purim who I would sit up until 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning with her in London, you know, after the gig at Ronnie Scott's, listening to stories about Jaco. And she was the one who said, "You should go to Berkeley." And she encouraged me to go and take the audition for the scholarship and head off to the States. And she introduced me to Kenwood Dennard, who then introduced me to Hiram Bullock. And, you know, through those guys, I worked with Jose Neto, who's a Brazilian guitarist who played in Fourth World in Ayeto and Flora's band. And I worked with him a bunch and played on a couple of his records. And then it ended up playing with Stevie Winwood through him. So that Brazilian thing, that Brazilian family and Brazilian influence has been a huge part of my music from day one when it comes to improvising, when it comes to playing the bass, and when it comes to playing this music in general. So perhaps that's what it is. I haven't thought about that at all until I saw your question today. So I hope that possibly answers your question. When you ask how you could incorporate that in your playing, I think it really doesn't matter what the subject matter is, whether it's Brazilian or Venezuelan or Peruvian or Colombian or whatever the rhythm is or the style. If you are immersed in that music, then it's going to come out and you're playing naturally. And that's what I say about the learning process, about my learning process, about the learning process I teach, the concepts I teach when it comes to music, and about being immersed in the music that you want to play, that you feel most connected to. And of course, sampling other music, being open-minded and not just soaking up this one thing, not having a singular influence. Really important to have a broad spectrum of input, but there's always going to be something you gravitate towards, you know, more than the rest of it. And for me, that was perhaps South American music, and quite specifically Brazilian music, and paired with a classical upbringing, you know, from coming from the classical guitar and just working on classical music a lot. Maybe that's where some of the note choices come from subconsciously, and the intervals and the scales and all of that stuff. I'm heavily influenced by classical music. So maybe for me, it's a combination of Brazilian and classical music. That's where I am today. Of course, Pat Metheny is a huge influence on me, and Brazilian music is an enormous influence on Pat. I think Pat probably has like 3 main influences in his life. It's Brazil, it's Jim Hall, and Wes Montgomery. I think that's probably it. And a bunch of Pat Martino in there as well. Not a lot of people talk about that so much, but he got a lot of stuff from Pat Martino. And then coming together with Lyle Mays to kind of create this vehicle for all of that stuff to work with the Pat Metheny group for 25 years or 30 or however long they were together. You know, that's about being immersed in something really specific. And perhaps I have a little bit of that. Pat has a huge amount of that. And if you want any part of that, I would suggest being immersed in something that you really love. And that's an awesome place to end. I love ending on a positive note. And thank you, guys. Q&A is done for today. Today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow.